In this lecture, we'll be looking at how to understand and fit data from powder X-ray diffraction. So more specifically, we will be looking at what the positions of the peak in the PXD data means, what the peak intensity means, and what the peak shape means. And then we will move on to how we can extract information from this type of data by real world refinement. And the video will be broken into, or the lecture will be broken into a number of shorter videos. So here we see a typical X-ray diffractogram. We see that that we have diffraction peaks from two different phases. So we have an aluminum oxide and a titanium dioxide. And of course, it's here we can clearly see that we have different components in the pattern. So we have some peak positions. So the angular positions of the peak. Then we have the peak intensity, which is like the height of the different peaks. And then, of course, we have the shape of the peaks, and we also have some background. And what is really important, and what I really, really want you to take away from this, is that this is called a diffractogram, a diffraction pattern, or just a pattern. It's not called a spectrum. Don't ever call it a spectrum, because spectrum, that word implies that we're doing something where the energy changes. And the whole point about diffraction is that the energy of the incoming wave remains constant in the outgoing wave. So this is not a spectrum. So typically when we plot our X-ray diffraction data, we plot it as the Bragg angle on the x-axis, and then the number of photon counts that the detector makes in the different angles on the y-axis. If we, like this case, have really small peaks here at higher angles, it can be beneficial sometimes to plot it either as the count either on a logarithmic or a square root scale. We of course also remember from Bragg's law that the angle, so we have Bragg's law up here, and the angle's theta depends on the wavelength. So therefore, if we change the wavelength that we use for collecting our data, we also change the angular positions. So therefore, we can sometimes plot. We can use different spaces to plot the diffraction. So instead of using 2 theta here, which is wavelength dependent, we can which we can see here, where we change from a copper K alpha to a molybdenum K alpha, where we see that the pattern looks the same, but for the molybdenum data, which is a lower wavelength, the peaks are like squished together at lower angles. So instead, we can plot as 1 over D, which means that these two data sets, where we have the copper K alpha and the molybdenum K alpha, these pattern, the position of the peaks in these patterns will be the same. Another option is to plot in Q space. Q is here 4 pi sine, and this should be a theta over lambda. And this is actually probably the best way of plotting diffraction data. So it's not tradition to do so, but it's definitely the best way, since we will have a wavelength independent plot, and also this way of plotting will not change the resolution of the data, whereas plotting as 1 over d will do that. Another option is to plot as a function of d. So here we see directly the interlayer spacings, so the spacings between the Miller planes in the structure. And this can be quite useful because we can directly read these distances in Ångström, but you also see that when we come to the low interplanar spacings, we don't really see anything. Also, I should mention that it can sometimes be good to plot the intensity, so on the y scale, on a normalized axis, because if we have data from two different instruments, or data that has not been collected for an equal amount of time, then the intensity will be quite different and it can be hard to compare, so therefore normalized intensity can be really good to use. So what we will be working on for this lecture is actually to fill in this table. So we will look at the different components in the pattern. So that's the peak positions, the peak intensity, peak shape, and the background. And we will see how are these affected by the crystal structure, sample property, and the instrument.